There's a full write-up in the back, in case you actually from 9 to 12.
Okay, 9 to 12. And part of the reason that it's 9 to 12, we're being very specific, is because we might have something else happening at the church later that day. Like a wedding. When members of the family of the church is right here. So we want it to look very, we want to do well by our missions team and their cause. We also want to be stick and stand and working our best selves for the wedding that we're going to be hosting. Yes?
Continuing with the plant sale. out in the parish hall, there's some daffodils that are blooming now, and as well as some hostas. So if you would like to buy them today, they're there for you. We've got. You might be more interested if they were blooming, and they might not be blooming by next Saturday.
Should they see you?
Sure.
Okay. Yes. So stand up. So, and if you're interested in the blooming daffodils, this is the blooming lady for today. Yes, Sue.
On that same note, I have hostas that I need to dig out. I need any kind of tops or white horse. Anybody have any?
For what?
There may be tops already outside under the stairs.
Also, no,
a church.
Okay, the pots under the stairs, if you have something more interesting, free. If you have more questions about the plant sale, see Kit or Meg. Are there other announcements for the life of the church and the community? Kit, have a
go. Nothing to do with plant sale. If you're interested in doing dinner for 7 or 8, you're folks going to have left. Either myself or Linda Hastings know by today.
Does everybody know what dinner for 7 is? Okay, so we're going to make an explanation. Kit, do you want to explain dinner for 7?
It's when we'll invite everyone into groups of 4 couples or singles. And you take a turn bringing an appetizer, and the couples will do the main meal. And then everyone else does the appetizer, the salad, and the bread. So it's easy. You don't have to do a whole meal. But it's a nice way to get to know people outside of coffee hours. And we hope that many people will join us would like to.
Yeah, and there are multiple groups of dinner for 7, and every year they change up the combinations of who's eating together. So you get together 3 or 4 times at different people's homes, you eat in people's homes, and you have conversations together you would never have here at the church, and get to know people in a more, in a deeper way. So we encourage people to do it if possible. If you're all interested in connecting, it's a great way to connect. Other announcements? Okay. Then please rise if you are able and join us for Lord of the Dance, which you can find on page 206 in your red hymnal.
Thank you.
please join me in the call of worship. So may you know the hope that is not just for Sunday, but for this day. Hope not made of wishes, but of substance.
Hope that,
hope that has breath and a beating heart.
Hope that will not keep quiet and be polite.
Hope that knows how to holler when it's called for.
Hope that knows how to sing when the seams arise.
Hope that raises us from the dead. Not Sunday, but this day. Every day, again and again and again. During this time of the service, we invite people to offer up their prayers, both of concern and of celebration. Often I will share with you those things that came up during the 8 o'clock service. And they're probably the same things that will come up today here. You think about the lands. There was a memorial service held just yesterday down in Exeter. Did anybody go to that? The Lundquist went and the Peppers went. Do you have anything that you want to share about that at all?
It was very well attended. There were a number of people from here, old friends from the valley and the church who were there. It was a celebration.
It was a celebration. So this is a celebration of the life Roland, who has, he was a good friend of our community, and members of our community went down to Exeter to, I think Exeter is the right place to say, to celebrate his life. And we continue to think of his wife as well. Also, we've been asked to lift up Ray Schoen in prayer. Ray had a bad day yesterday and ended up in the hospital for some diagnostics. It isn't clear that anything specific has occurred, but there does seem to be a change in his cognition. He is home. He just got up. So Arden is not here today, and she did speak with Cheryl and pass along a request that we will lift them up in prayer. And additionally, Ed Good, also a beloved member of our community who's living down in Massachusetts. I got to see him this week. He sent greetings. And we've been sending greetings back and forth. So if you feel like taking a picture or making a little video on my phone, I'll take it down with me the next time I go down and pass along your greetings to him. Other prayers that you might bring to this community. Then let us ask for prayers for our children who are, you know, went to prom last night, who are graduating and in transition, whether it's from high school or college, or children who are moving into a new place or a new job, and to other people in transition, transition from one kind of shelter to another, one kind of housing to another, one identity, moving into retirement or moving into a new job. We are so often in transition, and those are very stressful times. We lose track of how challenging they can be. Let us hold all people in transition in our prayers today. And may we also ask for healing, where healing is possible, stability of body, mind, and heart, where this is possible. And when people are saying goodbye, or going into a place they know that time is limited and they are seeking meaning, let us ask for comfort, for dignity, for clarity, and the chance for compassion, self-compassion, and compassion for others. We pray always for our sister church, the Chikanga Church, in the city of Mutare, and in the nation of Zimbabwe. They help us remember that we have brothers and sisters in many faiths all over the world, but these are our particular brothers and sisters partnered with us, and we pray for them. They sent this week pictures of the work that they are doing on their building. They're filling in the flooring now for the building that they're building, and so they continue to send us gratitude for the prayers that we offer to them and the partnership that we hold with them. Let us be in prayer. O Holiness, you wear the face of our brothers and our sisters. Where the Spirit lives, you move. And your Spirit lives in each of us, regardless of the color of our skin, or our gender, or our age, or our politics, or our tongue, or our faith. All of us are animated and moved by your Spirit. Let us recognize that kindred sense of being your children, your creation, and valuing each other. We ask for your presence, healing where it is needed, stability where it is needed, justice where it is called for, hope and resilience. We ask that you will help us recognize where we can be that source of strength and renewal for others. And we ask that you will be present to give the same to us when we need it. We ask for the clarity and wisdom for our leaders, both in our community and in our nation and around the world. And we ask that you will help us realize that we can affect change right here where we live. We ask that you will be with those who serve, who are called into places of risk. And we ask that you will be with those who wait for those who go to answer such a call. May those who are able return home safely to those who love them. Hear now our silence. And hear our words. As we pray together, the way you first taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and glory forever. Amen. I would invite the choir to come forward. What we just sang for you is a round that was written, it's a circle chant, written by Heather Pearson. She's a musician native to Mount Washington Valley. She has performed at the Whitney. She has performed here in the church. She will be offering a jazz worship service for us this summer. But one of her other gifts is that she composes these very simple songs, and really as a gift to spiritual communities, she's assembled them into a book, and she gave us a copy of it, and she's encouraging choirs and congregations to become familiar with these chants. They're very simple, well, they sound simple, but they're actually challenging to learn. I don't usually get to be in the choir, so speaking from novice experience here. Anyway, Heather offered this as a gift, and Emily took it up and helped us learn that this morning. So we give gratitude for the ways that people put their gifts to the use of others and open up topics for us. So I kind of ambushed David, but thank you. He's going to read our scripture this morning.
This part of your multitasking. Today's reading is from Acts 11, 1 through 18. The apostles and the brothers throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God. So when Peter went out to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him and said, "You went into the house of the uncircumcised men and ate with them." Peter began and explained everything to them precisely as it had happened. "I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision. I saw something like a large sheet being let out from heaven by its four corners, and it came down to where I was. I looked into it and saw four-footed animals of the earth, wild beasts, reptiles, and birds of the air. Then I heard a voice telling me, 'Get up, Peter, kill and eat.' I replied, 'Surely not, Lord. Nothing impure or unclean has ever entered my mouth.' The voice spoke from heaven a second time, 'Do not call anything impure that God has made clean.' This happened three times, and then it was all pulled up to heaven again. Right then, three men who had been sent to me from Caesarea stopped at the house where I was staying. The Spirit told me to have no hesitation about going with them. These six brothers also went with me, and we entered the man's house. He told us how he had seen an angel appear at his house and say, 'Send the doctor for Simon, who is called Peter. He will bring you a message through which you and all your household will be saved.' As I began to speak, the Holy Spirit came on them, and as he had come on us at the beginning, then I remembered what the Lord had said, 'John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' So if God gave them the same gift as he gave us, who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I to think that I could oppose God?" When they heard this, they had no further objections and praised God, saying, "So then, God has granted even the Gentiles repentance unto life."
Thank you. So, Peter is a follower of Jesus. And this book of Acts tells about this after Christ died. And after there were many sightings, post-resurrection sightings of Christ. And we remember that Christ said, repeatedly to the people that followed him, "Go and take care of the others who are my people." And also that even in Christ's own life, Christ had a learning curve about who were his people. He started out thinking that they were simply those who were Jewish and part of his tradition, but over time, he became the one who sat with people that were unacceptable, that were outside the bounds of society and his own tradition. And it was actually a woman who was seeking help for her child, who challenged her to think differently about those that were not of his faith, when she said, "Even the dogs under your table receive the scraps from your table, and am I not also worth whatever help you might give me? And here is Peter. He's traveling because that's what he was asked to do. Go out into the world and take care of others. Not necessarily to convert, but simply to be present and to tell what he has seen and what he has learned by following the way of Christ. And simply by being that person who is love, walking in the world, he opens up the door for others. But he's being fiercely questioned in this letter. He's actually explaining himself to others who object to the fact that he sat down with people that were outside of tradition. He ate food that was considered unclean. He broke a bunch of social taboos, social rules. And he says, who am I to argue with God? I had a dream. Three times I argued with what the dream told me about eating food that I shouldn't eat. And the Spirit says, you may eat what God has made clean for you. And he wakes up, and then messengers show up from this man named Cornelius, who will become so important in the early church. And Cornelius wants him to come and sit down and have a meal with his household. But Cornelius is not Jewish. And the food has not been prepared in a way that should be acceptable for Peter to eat it. And others get rid of it. They're like, what in the heck? You should not be sitting down at that table with those people. Who are those people? Who should be sitting down? We talked at the 8 o'clock about who's the other right now in your life. In your own life, you don't even have to travel to another part of the world to meet somebody who is different from yourself, other from yourself, who it might be challenging to sit at a table with. We're divided 50-50 over politics. You can start right there and realize how hard it is to even have a conversation with somebody who thinks differently from you, but is part of your community. And the exercise that Peter undertook and tells others, I was asked by God to do this, is to sit down the table with somebody who's somehow different from you, to be curious about them. Not necessarily to go there and change their mind, but simply be present and interested and realize that you can be part of the same community and you can be different. You don't have to agree on everything. Cornelius is not going to change his entire identity. But he's going to meet Peter in the middle. And he's going to become a huge supporter of this early movement and what it means. I was hoping Antonella would be here today because I wanted to talk about what it's like in our own world. To go think about what it is to be the other and to go out and meet the other in our world. First of all, there's a young man who works at the J-Town Deli. His name is Ben. There are two Bens. One's a little skinnier than the other. Skinny Ben fasts once a week. He doesn't make a whole lot of money. He's in food service. He has children. But once a week, he makes it a spiritual practice, an ethical practice, if you will, to fast. To know what it's like to have an empty belly. To not just reach out for the nearest cup of coffee. And he works in food service. He works at the J-Town, so all day long he doesn't eat very empty food. He makes food for other people and he doesn't eat anything. And he does it out of solidarity with families that, for instance, are benefiting from the J-Town's cause this month, 68 Hours of Hunger. There are families in Jackson who take home backpacks full of food, provided by the program called End 68 Hours of Hunger, to feed themselves and everyone else in their family. The whole family relies on what comes home in the backpack all weekend long. And Ben wants to know what that is like. And so he spends one day being hungrier than usual. And when he can, where he might have spent money on a cup of coffee or something like that, he redirects it to something that he believes in. Part of the call of this story is to figure out what it's like to be in the shoes, the life of the other. To sit down and have a small taste of that experience. And hunger's one metaphor and one experience, but there are so many. And then there are people like Jonathan Bliss, Antonella's husband, who died earlier this year. The family shared all these stories with me about Jonathan and how he was kind of famous for making friends no matter where he went. In point of fact, he was famous for, they would be going someplace and he and Antonella would sit down in a restaurant and he would say one thing to the manager and pretty soon the manager is sitting down with them and pouring extra glasses of wine and they get half of their dinner for free because he just made friends with people that he had never met before. And then, if you've met Antonella, you know that she's Italian. And for all the time they were married, her husband never learned Italian. And yet they would go every single year and they would visit her family and he would go off happily down to the market in the communities where her family lived. He would go to the post office, he would go to the butcher, he would go buy something. Every single time he came home with some goodie that somebody gave him because he made a friend. He couldn't speak the language. And the priest, even the local priest, said, I love it when I come over to your house for dinner and Jonathan walks me back to my place afterwards. We had the best conversations, but they don't speak the same language. And he comes up with a book that the priest gave him, or a letter that somebody gave him, a poem, or... He had all these meaningful engagements, and he never spoke the language of the people that he was making friends with. We have these amazing opportunities in our life to sit down with the other, to invite somebody to our house, to recognize that there's a person who's different from us and have a conversation. I know there are people in this congregation who are really good at that. I'm not going to name names, but I know people that are really good at making friends and finding out about people that you don't normally notice and bringing them little presents. Making them a homemade soup or something like that, or something else. Just paying attention to the world. This is what we're asked to do. Be curious about people who are different from us, especially now. Especially when we feel so divided. Especially when we feel othered right inside our own community, and yet this is exactly what we are called to do. To live in community. To find common causes. To recognize that there are things that we can do together, regardless of what we believe about other issues. One of them is to make food for each other and sit down at the same table. Or maybe it's to go clean up the road on the day that we pick up litter in the valley. Or maybe it's to help with a Boy Scout troop or a Girl Scout troop. Whatever the cause is, there are so many ways that we can agree to take care of each other and to take care of our world, regardless of the things that divide us. Because as Maya Angelou said, we are more alike than we are unlike. And the spirit that animates every one of us, the holy breath that resides in us, isn't just the people that were baptized in some Christian tradition. That Holy Spirit animates all beings. It animates creation itself, and it connects us beyond all the ways that we are divided. Peter learned this by sitting and then explaining it to other people. And Christ learned it from a woman who asked him for help. And when he first turned her away, she refused to be turned away. And she reminded him that she, too, was a daughter of God. We don't always remember it. But this story, like so many experiences in our lives, is to help us remember, to see the spark of the divine, the flame of the Spirit, the face of God in every other person, not just in our community, but around the world, and to see what is holy in the creation in which we walk. And to come like Peter, the one who says yes to the invitation, to sit down with somebody who's different than you are, and figure out what they have to share with you and offer to you. And for the world to get a little bit smaller because we're connected, and a little bit bigger because we opened a door. Who are we? Stand in the way of God. This is what Peter asked. God wants us to get out of the way and open the door and be curious and sit down together or go do some work together and see holiness in each other. Thanks be to God. Please rise, if you are able, for Psalm 401, Amazing Grace. Because we are able. We give what we are able to give. We ask no more than you are able to share in a way that is sustainable to you. But know that the offerings that you give, and we include your time and your talents and your touch as well as your treasure, these things are cherished and acknowledged, and they make a difference. But today, this morning, at this time, know that the offering you give goes in part to the people right in this valley to support programs such as M68 Hours of Hunger or the Way Station. And some of it also goes to places like our sister church in Zimbabwe and other places around the world where food is needed. Would those who open my ushers come for me?
Thank you.
and those who are different from you, as well as those who are part of your tribe. Go in peace.